your favorite cartoon characters will help you understand how drugs and alcohol can ruin your life. So watch the program. Talk about it with your family.
No, it's the three companions going along. You
I guess
know?
The car is the Ludo.
There you go. I guess what does the humbug add to this adventure? I mean, besides entertainment for the audience. I mean, what is his actual like thing? They're like, oh boy, this guy's gonna help us out a lot.
The humbug is kind of this. This is an unusual trope of character. I don't know what the TV trope's name for it is, but it's somebody who's always wrong, but at the right time.
Huh. How so?
Like when he's, his rule, his role is basically to jump in front of getting the wrong answer so Milo can get the right one.
Oh, okay. I gotcha. He's God, this it's so funny that this is not like a like explicitly religious Christian story, because it really follows the so many of the tropes of that stuff, where it's like, okay, look, we got our main guy who's like good, but you have the comic relief guy who's like who's going to like fall for every snare the devil like puts in his way, and
yeah, he's like Eric from Dungeons and Dragons basically.
Yes, exactly. All right, so he's useful. We're on our way to see the math magician, and I always thought it was weird as a kid that the math magician seems to not have anyone living in Digitopolis.
Yes, that is a really weird touch. This movie really skims over Digitopolis, but it also skims over everything that happened in between when they go to the Forest of Sight and the Valley of Sound, and they meet the Soundkeeper and Alec Bings. But at least they have the one character that I absolutely loved more than anything in this movie, which was the dodecahedron.
Okay.
This was to me what the character that I was obsessed with as a kid. So,
really, of all things, the dodecahedron. Yep, really,
this is how you know that I'm not really a furry. I really like inanimate objects. So I liked the dodecahedron.
Okay, that is interesting. Of all the ones to pick, because when I saw this movie, definitely like the things that stuck out to me were like anyone that like has a snout or it looks like an insect. So what is the What does the dodecahedron look like in the book? And I'm going to... It can't be that much different.
Well, the thing is, this book is not my first visit with the dodecahedron. He was the star of that selection from the textbook that I mentioned earlier. So...
Oh, so your first meeting with... first introduction to the toll booth was the dodecahedron.
Yes. So here is how...
This is
weird, isn't it?
Sorry. This is not what I expected. Because I was like, come on, it's a dodecahedron. It looks like, it looks like a Dungeon Dragons dice in the movie. And it's like, what else could it possibly look like? That's a dodecahedron. But no, they made him look, he's like a cubist painting.
Yeah,
here.
That's really clever, is that he has arms and legs and he's wearing a little hat.
Yeah, okay. Does the text describe him? Does it say that he's got a body?
It says, let me dig up the text for you. It's actually right here on the page that I sent, but I'll get the whole thing. As they argued, a most peculiar little figure stepped nimbly from behind the sign and approached them, talking all the while. Yes, indeed, it does. Certainly, yes, it does make a difference, undoubtedly. He was constructed, for that's really the only way to describe him, of a large assortment of lines and angles connected together into one solid many-sided shape, something like a cube that's had all its corners cut off and then had all its corners cut off again. Each of the edges was neatly labeled with a small letter and each of the angles with a large one. He wore a handsome beret on top, and peering intently from one of his several surfaces was a very serious face. Perhaps if you look at the picture, you'll know what I mean.
Okay, yes. I was about to say, it's like, God, props to Jules Feiffer for reading that and deciphering it somehow.
Yeah.
Because even Norton Jester gave up at the end.
Like, look at the picture. I don't know. However, I have, because I was prepared for this, I have, in fact, dug up the original illustration of the dodecahedron that I discovered as a kid. Here is the version that I grew up with.
This is from the textbook? Okay, so this is a lot less abstract, because Ralph Steadman. Jules Feiffer. No, is that Oprah's husband?
His last name is Steadman. I don't know if his first name is Ralph.
Oh, no. I was going to say, maybe I'm getting the name wrong. I was going to say Jules Feiffer's version looks like a Ralph Steadman illustration, the guy who illustrated Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas.
Oh, yeah, that guy. Inspector Mouse. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So very, like, yeah, just a very gonzo, very abstract, a little kind of wild.
Kind of, what the hell do I do with this drawing?
Yeah. I don't even know anymore. But this one, they're like, okay, we're going to make it a little more concrete for the children. Interesting that, again, it's not just a dodecahedron. He's got arms and legs that seem to be made out of...
angles?
Shapes?
Yeah.
And he's...
You can see, like, there are little joints that kind of show the range of what angle he can spread these limbs at. He looks like Pac-Man,
and he's got, like, he does, kind of. And he's got a little sailor hat, like Donald Duck, which also seems to have 12 sides as well.
Nice little touch there.
I guess that's, the beret. But, okay. I feel like all these interpretations of the dodecahedron are adding a lot of unnecessary bells and whistles to something that is literally self-explanatory. It's like, if you just say, there's a dodecahedron, it's like, I can see it in my mind. It's a shape. Why are we adding all these frills?
Well, if you're a kid, you might not know the word. I mean, Milo doesn't know the word when he meets him in the movie.
Yeah, but then they say it. Like, talk is like it's a 12-sided figure. It's like, I actually didn't realize dodecahedrons were real. I thought they were made up for the movie. But I mean, I also thought that coyotes and roadrunners were made up. So
yeah. Every Christmas, I see something from somebody. People who are like, did you know reindeer are real?
Yeah. Yeah. That's me. That was me. I was a very dumb kid. That's funny though. Literally, I would see things. No, maybe I was too smart, because I would see things on TV and be like, clearly those are not real. like other kids, would see something on TV and believe it. And I was like, no, coyote, that is clearly a fictitious animal that was made up. I don't believe
it. Well, you probably saw the made up scientific name for it and thought that was proof.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I mean, Roadrunner, I can kind of see because it's such a ridiculous looking bird. You know, and it doesn't look like a real roadrunner at all. The coyote, I mean, is a little like, okay, that's it just, yeah, I mean, that's not as silly looking, and it's a little closer to a real coyote
looks
like. Just
a dude in a fur suit, for the most part.
Yeah. I mean, I also thought the Tasmanian devil was made up.
A lot of people think the Tasmanian devil is made up.
Yeah. So I feel like, I did believe Marvin the Martian was real, though.
And while we're on this subject, here's that same book's interpretation of Milo talking the humbug.
Okay, whoa. Okay, whoa. So talk is literally just an alarm clock with a head sticking out of it. Milo, I don't. The only way I can describe Milo is he looks like he should be on like an 1860s broadsheet poster advertising, like, I don't know, like sugar or something, you know, like moms, feed sugar to your tots, give them rosy cheeks, you know. You know what I mean? Like when you see those really old posters, like Victorian, like ones. Oh, yeah.
Makes children and adults fat as pigs.
Yeah, that sort of thing. Exactly. And the humbug is, okay, so it looks, it's like a pinheaded toad. I don't know. What is this? What is going on there? Oh my God. Wow. Okay. Interesting interpretations here. So Ethan, so this was an excerpt from, oh, okay, never mind. It looks like they've got like a little thing introducing it, right? Okay, because I was gonna say, like, if you just saw this without the introduction of talk, you'd be like, what the fuck is this dog that's a clock? But it looks like they give you like a summary, so you aren't like completely lost about what's going on here. Okay. But I understand that this really sold you on the dodecahedron.
Yeah, I can't tell you why as an adult, but as a kid I was like, this is my favorite character forever. I love him.
Well, I mean, Ethan, you do like robots.
Yeah, he's kind of robot-ish, you know? Yeah.
That is a recurring theme, because I know besides Transformers, a lot of, you know, robots are kind of a recurring motif, a leitmotif, if you will, in your work.
Yes, I have I tend to get a little bit meta about them.
Yeah, and I feel like these interpretations I feel like just saying that like robots are your thing is kind of like being glib. I feel like that's kind of simplifying a little too much, because it's not merely robots. I feel like there's something about automatons or something about artificial life, maybe.
You could. I'm sure there is.
Yeah.
You know, I couldn't tell you the actual theme myself, even though I live with it every day. But yeah, I'm definitely fascinated by, you know, maybe effigies is the word. Things like the Scarecrow, the Tin Woodsman, Jack Pumpkinhead, that kind of thing.
Yeah, yeah. No, I think that's a good way to put it. Because, yeah, when I say robot, I'm just thinking, no, it's not that you're like, oh, I love the beepity boops, you know? Beepity beepity boop. It's like, no, that's not right. That's not it. That's not grokking it. But this version of the dodecahedron, like, I look at it and it's like, oh, I can see the influence in some of the designs of some of the characters that you've come up with.
Interesting. You can? Like. I'm not going to ask you to name them, but that's pretty interesting that you can see that much influence on my work.
Yeah, like, I can't, like, quite put my finger on it. I wouldn't be able to define it any more than that, but I feel like there's an ineffable something about this picture that I feel is reflected in some of your later work, at least. And this is the same dodecahedron. Oh my God. I can't believe the dodecahedron is fucking dead.
Yeah, he falls into the cave in the book. So,
oh geez. So sucks to be him. What happens to him?
Yeah. As it turns out, the dodecahedron in the book is kind of like, you know, the sidekick or undersecretary to the math magician.
Oh, okay. So he's not just a doorman.
Yes.
Also, I'm sorry, this other picture that you posted of Milo, I'm losing my mind here.
You didn't think he could get more 70s than this movie, did you? You were wrong!
Oh, my. That is up with people, you know.
Hooray for everything.
However, I do really like the math magician here with his beard made out of numbers. That's kind of cool. It looks like they're kind of going with the same thing as in the movie, though, where he kind of lives in a crystal cave of numbers.
Yes, this is an interesting aspect of this series, series of one, is that it's established that letters are grown, but numbers are mined.
Oh, okay, interesting.
And I think that makes sense, yeah, because, okay. I mean, letters, you know, we make up new ones all the time. What do you think emoji are? But numbers, I mean, a one is a one anywhere you go. There's no such, you know, you may draw it differently, but it still means the same thing. They are ideograms as opposed to standing for sounds.
Oh, interesting. Yeah. The math magician here also has a pencil staff, just like in the movie.
Yes, that was in the book. It's that he has a giant pencil.
Oh, okay.
So here, let me share with you, now that we're past the Mathemagic, the 1978 Childcraft Annual edition of the Phantom Tollbooth. Here is the Mathemagician.
Does the dodecahedron die when he falls into the cave? What happens?
No, he's fine. He's okay.
Oh, okay. All right. Okay, good. Anyway. Oh, okay. So, interesting. He's
a lot beefier.
In the movie.
Here, yeah.
He is, yeah. In the movie, the Mathemagician is just King Azaz, but thinner.
Yeah, tall and thin and with buck teeth.
Yes. Here he's very beefy. He's got these kind of like he's got your typical wizard's robe and hat, you know, the pointy hat. It looks like it's covered in like mathematical equations.
Yeah, it's covered in like calculus. I can't imagine how much time Jules Feiffer must have spent on this one drawing.
The interesting thing I think is I would have expected like, you know, a long Gandalf-y beard, but instead he's kind of got these. They look like kind of this very Irish Uncle Dundreary thing going
yeah,
on.
Yeah, he's almost,
you know,
got an Amish beard going on compared to Azaz.
Yeah.
And Azaz had a big long beard in the book.
Yeah, he's got like he's kind of got a chin strappy thing, I guess, is that what we call this sort of thing? I'm not but yeah, he's not what I would have expected at all from and he's got sandals. So sandals. I mean, he's a wizard. So.
Crocs.
He is a wizard, right? I mean, Crocs, yeah.
So, yeah, we are introduced to the Mathemagician in the book, in the movie, after there's this incredibly brief moment where Milo, Talk, and the Humbug are trying to get into the numbers mine, which is how you get into Digitopolis. But all they ever see of Digitopolis is the Mathemagician's workshop. We don't see any of the other residents, but we're told in the book that the numbers mine is absolutely full of miners.
Oh, okay. Interesting. But we don't see them.
We don't see them in the movie. Oh, I do have a picture of them from the book if you want. I mean it's just a miner, but
see.
Yeah. So let me see. Let's see if we can find it. Ah. And here we tick go. Yep. Just a dude with no shirt.
That's a miner.
Yep.
I would believe that is a miner.
I guess that's a beard. He might have duck bill. I don't know.
Yeah. It's a dude who mines numbers. Okay. Yeah, I believe
but
it.
But if you look back at the Childcraft Annual version, you will see that the miners are all wearing tall pilgrim hats. They look kind of elfin.
Huh. Maybe, are they supposed to be Tommyknockers or something?
Oh, that's interesting.
You know?
That's a good... fanon.
Oh, actually, you know what? Maybe they are, because Tommyknockers are mind sprites,
exactly.
Who I believe are originally from Cornwall mythology, which is where pilgrim hats are from, maybe.
And we are specifically told it took several minutes for their eyes to become accustomed to the dim light, and during that time, strange scratching, scraping, tapping, scuffling noises could be heard all about them. Which is exactly what Tommyknockers do.
Yeah, there you go.
So they're Tommyknockers or they're kobolds.
Oh, they are. But they don't look like sexy little lizard people. I've complained about that like so many times on this show.
that kobolds don't look like sexy little lizard people? I thought they were dogs.
Well, no, you're thinking of gnolls.
Okay.
No, you know, because in Dungeons and Dragons, they're these little like lizard people, right?
Mm.
Kobolds. But, you know, that's not what they are in you know, in actual legend. They're just little dudes who like...
Yeah, that...
Do mind
That's the
shit.
Thing is that
well,
we
I mean,
have,
you know.
You know, we have all these different variants on basically the same creature. You have a little creature that lives in your house. Is it a hobgoblin? Is it a boggart? Is it a zashiki waraji? No, it's all the same thing. It's just a little thing you leave milk out for. Is it a kilmulis? Same thing. And they use the exact same thing for all these different creatures that you're supposed to hear in a mine. And, you know, is it a kobold? Is it a Tommyknocker? No, it's just somebody playing a prank on you.
Yep. I remember as a kid in Germany, you know, where they translate most like wee folk as kobolds.
Oh, interesting.
Which is like, which, you know, usually if you're watching a TV show and there's like, elves or gnomes or something, it's like, yeah, sure, whatever. But it gets weird when like you're watching cartoon, like, you know, a Bugs Bunny cartoon where he's like fighting a leprechaun and they keep referring to it as a kobold. It's like, that is clearly not a kobold. That is a leprechaun. That is a very specific thing, you know. Yeah, I don't know, whenever I think of kobolds, I still think of fucking Pumuckl. So you know, and everyone, but here in America, everyone just knows D&D kobolds. It's like, no, they're little lizard people with giant dump truck asses that we've all decided, apparently.
I was not there for that
anyway.
Vote.
No, oh, well, let me tell you. Well, yeah, I mean, I shouldn't get mad. I voted twice in that. I put all the ghost votes in, but anyway. Anyway, where were we?
Mathemagician. Yes, in the movie, our characters meet the mathemagician and... Now, we've been glossing over the songs, but this is an interesting thing about the song, is that King Azaz and the Mathemagician both have a song that go to the same tune. But one thing I think is very interesting is that King Azaz's song rhymes and the Mathemagician's doesn't.
Oh. Huh.
Which I'm not. I'm wondering if that was intentional or not, because the song is actually derived from something that the dodecahedron says in the book. He's the one who talks about how could you have high hopes without knowing how high they are? How could you enjoy anything at long last without knowing how long the last was? And that's where the lyrics are derived from, and the lyrics for Azaz's song are sort of back engineered from.
Hmm. Okay. Interesting. I guess you know. I mean, I guess these songs are okay.
Yeah. I mean, there's deeper levels to them than you can imagine, but. Well, I'm sure you can imagine them, but they're deeper than you might think immediately. But all the same, I agree with you that the songs could be better. I mean, there's nothing that whips as much ass as where there's a whip, there's a way. So,
yeah.
Seriously.
But I mean, there's nothing that whips that much ass in The Little Mermaid either, so.
Well, yeah, okay.
So, yeah, we have... So... They meet the mathemagician, who is cordial and eager to explain to them how much he loves numbers, and he seems to be the only resident of Digitopolis besides the dodecahedron. And this is where we get the moment that was the origin of the whole book. Do you know this story?
No.
So what happened was Norton Juster was sitting waiting for a table at a restaurant. And a little boy just sits down next to him and says, "What's the biggest number?" This was before Stranger Danger, he explains. Kids would just address adults like that. And he said, "Well, what's the biggest number you can think of?" And the kid gives some ridiculous 900 bazillion jillion number. And he says, "Okay, well, add one to it." And that ended up kind of being the seed around which the Phantom Tollbooth was built, was this little conversation with this kid who was, you know, clearly very smart, but was not being challenged.
That's interesting. It's kind of interesting that that of all things is what led to this whole book.
Yeah. I mean, it was part that and partly the fact that he had absolutely no interest in this book about civic planning for kids. So he wrote this book instead and said, I'm sorry, I spent that all the grant money and I didn't make the book you wanted. I made this book instead. And he didn't get a response, but they didn't ask him to give the grant back either.
Wow. Okay. Well, man, it was a different world
it
back
sure
then,
fucking
you know?
Was.
I mean, you do that today and they would be like, yeah, you're going to jail forever.
Okay. So yeah, we have, so they make friends with the mathematician who thinks that bringing the princesses back would be a terrific idea until he hears that Azaz is all for it and says, no, if he's for it, then I'm against it. We don't agree on anything, which again, this is a great moment. Milo points out that so anything you don't like, he does. Anything he does like, you don't. So you agree to have opposite opinions. And, you know, he just completely destroys him with facts and logic and he crumbles. And everybody clapped.
Hoisted by his own petard.
Well, first he had to get them to agree that if I can prove that you do agree on something, will you let us go? And
mm-hmm.
So, yes, he does. And also, both King Azaz and the mathematician have given them gifts as weapons to take with them. Azaz gave him a big bag of ideas. The mathematician gave him a pencil, which he says is a miniature magic staff, just like his own.
Oh, okay, yeah. That comes in useful in the movie as well. He gets that.
Yeah, we get some uses for that in the book, but the movie really takes it in a whole new direction. Because in the movie, we get a big fight with monsters that doesn't happen in the book at all.
Oh, really?
No.
Oh. All right. Well, that's a shame, because that's a good bit.
It is a good bit, and they were smart to do it. But I also like the ending of the book, too. So.
All right. Well, we'll see when we get there what that's all about. Okay. So and now that they're heading out of Digitopolis, well, the movie, I think we get Chroma the Great now,
yes,
don't we?
Yes, Talk has been talking up Chroma the Great as the one sane man left in the whole kingdom. And who he is this conductor who stands at the edge of a cliff and conducts the world's colors. And we don't see them in the movie, but in the book we see that he has a giant orchestra reaching to the end of the horizon. And even when he sleeps, they continue playing to keep the music going.
Oh, interesting. Yeah, in the movie, he's just a conductor who just conducts, like, the sky.
Yeah, and Milo sees him personally conduct a beautiful sunset, and there's a little bit of music to it, but it is mostly about the color effects. So this is a good place for Chuck Jones to show his color theory chops.
Now, in the book, he specifically just conducts colors?
Yes, not music, just the colors.
Okay.
And Milo actually asks him, well, what would happen if they stopped? And Chroma says, see for yourself. And he makes the throat cutting gesture and all the color stops. Mm-hmm. And the whole world looks like a coloring book that hasn't been colored.
Oh, weird. Because the movie, I just assumed like, oh, he conducts the weather, like the sunrise and sunset, I thought was kind of the thing.
No, it is, in fact, the colors, not the not the weather. The weather doesn't really come into play.
Yeah, actually, because in the movie, like, that's the thing is, like, Chroma tells Milo to wake him up for the sunrise, I think.
Yes.
And then that's why Milo wants to hang around, and Humbug convinces him, no, just do it yourself, and then we'll go on our way, and Milo fucks it up. So it really, in the movie, it really seems to be, like, he conducts, like, the heavens, like, the sun and the moon and that sort of thing. But the book, it's just colors specifically.
Yes, and in the book we see that Milo accidentally... He does do this. He tries to conduct it himself, but he makes a mistake and ends up fast-forwarding by a week. So 7 days pass at once before he finally manages to get the orchestra to calm down, and he goes to wake up Chroma, and Chroma's like, oh dear, four minutes late, I'll have to cut my lunch hour short.
Wait a minute, so it's like, so he also conducts time.
Yeah, I guess so. Wow. And it says that no one, except anyone who was awake at 5:23 that morning, knows about the lost week.
That's actually, that's pretty amusing. Okay, so...
But Milo ditches in the middle of this, leaving all of the colors totally messed up for the rest of the movie.
Now, does... it sounds like... But in the book, he doesn't have to feel bad and guilty about messing up the sky for the rest of the
movie. No, yeah. They gave him... You know, this... That is kind of a problem I have with Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory. I hate the fizzy lifting drinks scene. You know, some people have have defended it, but I don't like that, you know, that they made Charlie, you know, so, you know, just like all the rest.
Oh, yeah.
Because there was no fizzy lifting drinks scene in the book. He was just the winner by default, but because he was good.
Yeah. I guess, what was the point of the fizzy lifting drinks in the movie? That was just so...
It was, well, for one thing, it was mentioned in the book, and it was be a good scene, I guess. But they had also added the whole subplot about sneaking the everlasting gobstoppers out to Slugworth. That wasn't in the book either. So the idea here was to test whether or not Charlie was honest enough that even when he had a good reason to defraud Mr. Wonka and sell off the gobstoppers to Slugworth, he was still honest enough to give it back anyway. But I don't buy that crap.
Yeah. I mean, the one thing I'll say for the fizzy lifting drink, since it gives us one of the one of the great internet jokes where it's like, you know, you stole fizzy lifting drinks, four surly Oompa Loompas hold you down. Which I think was the beginning of some RP someone was doing that got screen capped.
I don't know this one, and I've been subjected to a lot of Wonka based internet fetishes.
Yeah, there's it's a rich vein.
Oh, have you noticed that is what makes the Phantom Tollbooth stand apart from Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory and Charlotte's Web? No one got any weird fetishes from the Phantom Tollbooth.
That's true. Gosh, you're right. Nobody's hot for like dogs with like clocks in their stomachs or
I can think of is that maybe you would get like a thing for melting from the Lothargians and the Gelatinous Giant, but
you're right, because I feel like generally you're going to get fetishes from parts of these films that kind of upset you or disturb you, and I feel like those are the most striking visuals of this film. Well, maybe that's, you know, it flopped, so not enough kids saw it.
But I thought those other movies were flops too. You know, most of these internet fetishes you acquire from watching it on repeat and on VHS and being like, you know, I hope adult me can figure out what my feelings are about this.
Yeah. You know, I don't know. Maybe I guess not enough kids watched this on VHS or something. Did anyone else watch this one?
I will tell you, this was the first movie I ever rented, and I was so excited because I was in that dodecahedron phase.
I really hope they get the dodecahedron,
yeah,
you know?
He was there, but I was disappointed. He was not as prominent as he was in the book.
He doesn't fall into a cave.
Well, I mean, he falls into the cave, but, I mean, he leads them into the cave, so...
Oh, okay. Okay. Anyway, so after Chroma, what happens? Where do we go from there?
After Chroma, we first... I didn't share the picture of Chroma. Not that it's that different.
Oh, yeah, let's see Chroma.
Let's see. It's...
Now, let's take a look at this guy. Does he look like a... Because in the movie, he looks like kind of like Jay Sherman, but with like a weird...
He does.
Like swoop in his
hair. No, but yeah, in... Here he is, and my thumb, and, you know, he's...
Oh, yeah. He looks more like a conductor.
Yeah, he looks like, you know, he'd pass by and you'd be like, Leopold, Leopold, Leopold.
he's less conductor, more Old West Undertaker. Yeah.
And the part that they, the part that Jules Feiffer, whose name I keep having to refer to the cover of the book to remember, the part he seems to have been inspired by is Juster describing him as molding the air like handfuls of soft clay.
Oh, yeah, I can see that. He's got like a lot of joints in that wrist.
Yeah, that is a very Ren and Stimpy hand.
Yeah, yeah. All right, so after leaving, I think now we're finally getting into the monsters,
yes,
right?
Yes, the monsters of ignorance. We head into the... They eventually have to leave the car behind, but first they encounter the first monster, who is the Senses Taker, who is this little old man in a green visor, the kind that Frank Zappa talked about, rewrote black songs to be palatable for white audiences. And yeah, and he has a, and so he questions them on everything, on pretty much all of their personal information, so he can take their senses, as in taking their sense of duty, their sense of honor, and their sense of direction. But Talk has the bottle of laughter that he either got from the soundkeeper in the book and from Dr. Discord in the movie. And that is the one thing that the Senses Taker is helpless against, because he cannot take your sense of humor.
Okay. Yeah. This sounds like this is pretty much similar to the movie.
Yes.
Okay. So this scene plays out the same. Do we have a picture of the Senses Taker?
Yeah.
Do we know what he looks like?
Here we go. And he looks... And you are going to think he's familiar because he looks a lot like the artist that you mentioned earlier, Stedman.
Oh yeah.
Look at
yeah,
that.
Even
yeah.
with the ink blots.
The ink
yeah.
blots everywhere, yeah.
That's yeah, his depiction in the movie is pretty similar. A lot of ink, and like kind of like a guy who's dressed like an old timey clerk with one of those bank visors and fingerless gloves.
Yeah,
in the movie,
I gotta say, I think that they were kind of going for the triple parentheses around this guy.
Oh, problematic. Yeah.
Especially since Juster himself was Jewish. Feiffer was.
Oops.
Feiffer still is. Jules Feiffer is still with us. Norton Juster died just this year. So.
Oh, geez. Oh.
He was 91, so... So write a beloved children's book and you'll live to your 90s too.
Well, we should all be
working
so lucky. all right. So he's our first monster, even though he's not really a monster. He's just a guy.
Yeah, he's just kind of holding them steals. Up. But he alerts all the other demons.
Okay. So, oh, he does. Oh, no. Okay. Then who else do we get?
We get the most beloved one of all, the terrible Trivium.
Oh, this guy is fucking spooky.
Yeah.
He looks very much like in the movie. I'd say almost exactly the same, except that he's got wrists.
Yeah.
Because the movie version, his head and hands are kind of floating, not really attached to his
body.
Yeah,
he's like an invisible man. He's wearing gloves, but you can see through his wrists. But he has a head, a featureless head, but it's not connected by a neck.
Yeah. Like, as a kid, I found this guy extremely unnerving. I mean, this was... I did not like this guy. Like, the other demons, I was pretty much like, oh, these are cool, but this guy, I'm like, I don't like him. He's like... He's... You know, I mean, I think that's a pretty standard Uncanny Valley type response when it's like, oh, it's human, except with no face.
Yes.
How many creepypastas use that exact same premise?
I mean, it's like, literally a yokai. That's called a noparabo.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah,
I also, as a kid...
And it likes to first look like a beautiful lady who's weeping by the side of the road, like La Llorona, and then you stop to help her, and then she looks at you, and she has no face! And you run away!
Oh, shit.
And then you... find like a ramen shop and you try to tell the restaurateur, I just saw a lady, she was so beautiful, but she had this face like, and he turns around like this.
Oh shit.
And it's usually just Tanuki's fucking with you, so.
Oh, okay. Well, yeah.
That's the thing
that.
About mythical creatures is some of them are just other mythical creatures playing with you.
Man, you know, you just don't know what to believe.
You know, maybe that's the thing about kobolds is that any mythical creature that you run into in Germany is a kobold pretending to be an elf or a leprechaun or whatever.
I mean, you know, yeah, there's Stranger Things. I actually thought when I was a kid that the terrible Trivium was like the leader of the monsters.
He seems to be. He has a kind of, you know, it's kind of like how we see Dracula as the leader of the universal monsters.
Yeah. I think because he returns in the big climactic battle.
Yeah, we don't see that in the book.
Oh, okay. And also, like, I know that, like, when, I mean, maybe I'm getting ahead, but, like, when Milo basically drops the bomb on the Trivium, all the other monsters merge together into like the one big monster. So I was like, oh, they're responding to seeing their leader destroyed by doing this final, like, you know, volley of merging.
Yeah,
I don't know if that's I don't know if that's actually what they intended with that, but that's how I interpreted it.
Yeah, you know, we tend to think of humanoid monsters, especially the ones that are humanoid enough to wear clothes, as being leaders among monsters.
Yeah, I guess maybe I'm just being anthropocentric. I don't know, but you know, he seems like he's in charge. So who else
okay,
we got?
Then we've got the demon of insincerity, also known as the long-nosed, green-eyed, round-bodied, broad-shouldered, fat-lipped, big cankled monster.
He's like a little like in the movie he looks like a he's just a little hairball.
Yeah, he's like a little tribble thing.
In fact, when we were watching it the other day, Moody thought he actually looked really cute.
Yeah, he is cute,
and he kind of does. Not so much here. He's like, oh, what this is? Some sort of like shaved rabbit with no ears.
Yeah, it looks like an upright guinea pig who is kind of, you know, rubbing his hands together cravenly.
Yeah. Well, I don't think that's not cute. That's not cute at all. I don't like this guy. Oh, yeah. Get this guy out of here. I say no, thank you. When I see this guy, I'm like that one meme. I had just about enough of this guy.
And then they are attacked in the movie by the gelatinous giant.
Is that also in the book, like directly after that? So the gelatinous giant in the book, he looks a little more humanoid. He's got hair.
Yeah. Does he have hair? I can't even tell.
Well, I thought
maybe
he did.
Yeah.
Let me see. Is that just shading?
Yeah, he might have a sort of long haired hairstyle that makes him look like the mountains around him. And he's also got his knees and shoulders drawn up to look more like, look like peaks too. So that's and his Jules Feiffer really went all out on the kind of modeling of his body with long pen strokes.
Yeah, I can't tell if he has a mustache or not, or if that's just cross-hatching, you know, as shading. Because it looks like he's got kind of a big bushy mustache to me.
Maybe.
But
let me see. There is another picture of him. Later we see a bunch of monsters all together, and the gelatinous giant is there with them. Is that him? No, that's not him. I left it out of this picture. Okay, I'll have to take another one. But yes, let's just, you know, blow your mind with a ton of monsters at once. Here we go. Monster number one. He likes to frolic in the sun.
All right, so we got a bunch of monsters here. We got something. It's like a looks like some sort of bovine with like a big frog mouth and a tongue. It's got like 8 nostrils. It's got like elephant feet, and there's a little dude sitting on it. Very Hieronymus Bosch with this guy. And then there's like a guy who's like just like a big head with like legs. This guy, he looks like one of those balloon heads from Junji Ito, or maybe one of another those, what do they call them? The Grylos on the old, you know, again in Bosch paintings.
Yeah.
Then I see in the background two things that look like, I don't know, like sheep with human heads, like, and then like
newborn puppies.
Yeah. And then there's a thing that, what is that, with like some sort of moose with a cat face, and it's got kind of like buffalo horns, and then something in the air. Is that the gelatinous giant back there? What is that?
Oh, in the top right corner, that is oh, what's it called, the dirty bird?
Oh, the word snatcher.
The word snatcher, yes.
Who we haven't met yet, no. But I guess he also comes back.
He doesn't show up in the book, in the movie at all. So
no, he does not. So this is the end when all the monsters return, when calling all monsters happens.
Yes, make my monster grow, and let's see. I think okay. So the guy in front, I'm pretty sure the one who's all head, that is the overbearing know-it-all who we see in the movie.
Right. We do get him. Yes.
And writing on the back of the thing with eight noses, that is the threadbare excuse, who we also see in the movie.
Okay. All right.
And I believe that the one that he's writing on is the gross exaggeration, whose grotesque features and thoroughly unpleasant manners were hideous to see, and whose rows of wicked teeth were made only to mangle the truth. He seems to have taken a few liberties with that one.
Yeah, we don't see that one in the movie.
And then we have on the second page.
Okay, let's see who we got here. All right, we got some guy. We only see it in the bottom left-hand corner, kind of. He's just peeking over the edge. He's got a really long scarecrow arm. He's wearing a scarecrow hat. Oh, his other arm is coming over too, and that's a short, stubby one. He's got two mismatched arms.
Yes, these guys are called the Triple Demons of Compromise.
Okay.
Yeah, see the two of them that are above him? Yes.
Yes.
One tall and thin, one short and fat, and the third exactly like the other two. As always, they moved in ominous circles, for if one said here, the other said there. The third agreed perfectly with both of them. And since they always settled their differences by doing what none of them really wanted, they rarely got anywhere at all, and neither did anyone they met.
Okay. All right, I guess I see where he's going with this. Yeah.
I think Feiffer was angry at him. He was like, how am I supposed to draw this?
Yeah. Well, it's funny when you say, like, the Germans of compromise. It's like, oh, yeah, and we all know. We all hate compromise. What a terrible thing that is. But I get what he's saying. I get this. All right.
It just makes me think of, you know, like, you know, Rorschach. Live life without compromise.
Yeah. So who else we got here? I see there's the demon of insincerity, it looks like, up there in the left-hand corner.
Yeah, there he is.
Top left.
I have no idea who the merman with the long beard is.
Yeah, I was wondering about that. And I see a guy over here who I assume is the hind-hopping.
Yeah, horrible hopping hindsight.
That's him, yes. Since he seems to be got his head on backwards. And then there's like some sort of weird like anthro like lion unicorn type thing.
Ah,
what
yes.
is that?
That would be, I believe that's the dilemma. So if you've ever heard of being tossed on the horns of a dilemma, this is the dilemma you've heard of.
Oh, I have not heard that. Yeah. I didn't realize that was a saying, but
you
know,
it's sort of like how no one actually says an awful din anymore.
Yeah.
Yeah, today
I'm
he'd
sure
be the terrible racket.
It. Yes. And there's something else. I see a face kind of peeking in from the right-hand side of the picture. Do we know who this is?
No, I have no idea who this thing with wings for ears is. This reminds me a lot of that one Babar card story where the demons that say like sloth and ignorance and gluttony are flying into his house, and Babar is like, ugh, fah, go away quickly.
Don't they get chased away by like winged elephants?
Yes,
I remember
that's the
that.
One, yeah.
Wow. Oh, I do remember that one.
Only 30s kids will remember.
It's like Babar's opium trip. All right. So a lot of these, so some of these monsters we do get to see in the movie. I will say I actually think, I mean, these are they're different. These are pretty cool monsters too. The only one I would say is without a doubt far superior in the movie is the threadbare excuse.
Yes, who is literally just a few lines walking along. It's kind of terrifying.
Yeah, I feel like Jules Feiffer didn't really do much with the concept. He's just like, yeah, just draw a guy. I'm gonna draw a guy. You know. Yeah.
This, by the way, is what you were talking about earlier about the drawings where you can still see the pencil lines.
Yes, yes. We get a lot of that in this whole monster sequence. But actually, wait, before we get to the big monster fight, is there anything that they meet in the movie between the gelatinous giant and the big monster fight?
No, the gelatinous giant is the last one.
Okay, all right. So then they get into the monster fight because we don't get the ever ready word snatcher. Yeah. Okay, are there any other monsters they meet in the book that are left out of the movie before the fight?
No, the movie describes the Gorgons of Hate and Malice, who I don't think get drawn in this, but they might be the things that look like newborn puppies.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I actually really, when I was a kid, I really loved the Gorgons of Hate and Malice.
Did you think they were bats?
Sorry, what?
Did you think they were bats?
No, but I actually got confused and thought they were the Gorgons of Kate and Alice.
The Gorgons of Kate and Alley.
Yeah, I mean, I just thought that was their names. But it did cause me for years to believe that Gorgons were just giant snails.
You know, what is up with when Gorgons get portrayed as bull monsters?
Oh, yeah, that's actually, that is a
weird Dungeons and Dragons thing that I've never understood.
That is actually in some medieval bestiaries.
Really?
I think.
Weird.
That's where it comes from.
So they got it like confused with the catablepus?
Yes. I think it's actually, yeah, because it's has the same power to like kill you with its gaze that a Medusa has. But yeah, it kind of got like conflated with the catablepus and just became like a scaly bull, you know?
Yeah. I don't like that. I don't like having to refer to Gorgons as Medusas.
Yeah, it's like calling all vampires Draculas, you know?
Or calling all Frankensteins Franken. Oh, wait. Shit.
Yeah. Oh, wait, because it was like, I guess people are like, oh, you know, it's like how Dracula's like the king vampire. It's like Medusa's the king Gorgon.
And, you know, and referring to all rock stars as Elvises.
Yeah, that's right. I'm just going to start doing that. Yeah. Yeah, I'm gonna...
What are you, some kind of Elvis?
Yeah, I'm going to be like, no, the Elvis concert. It's like, well, what do you mean? It's like, no, I just call all rock stars Elvises. You know, it's like in the South, how they call all soda Coke.
Britney Spears is my favorite Elvis. How about you? Free Elvis.
Anyway, so let's see. So they kill a bunch of these monsters.
Yeah, they
Oh, wait a second. Oh, sorry. Go on.
Go on.
we missed what is it? The two-headed the two-faced hypocrite.
Yeah, that was not in the book. That was a monster that was original to the movie.
That one, okay, that was kind of a clever one, I thought.
Yeah, this two-headed dragon that, and this is where Milo pulls out his magic pencil and starts using the ideas together with numbers, but it's kind of, he mostly just uses the numbers to form a bow.
Yeah. I mean, he doesn't really... Yeah, this whole thing is a little strange because, like, he's going to use the power of words and, like, letters and numbers to defeat deadly sins, I guess? It's like, I'm really... What is the thread of this metaphor? Like, what, not really sure how that's working, but okay. But yeah, he just basically, like, draws a bunch of catapults and stuff, doesn't he? Oh, sorry, hello?
Just had to give a note that I was... still recording.
Oh, did it do the thing where it's like, are you sure you're still there?
No, that was a knock on my door.
Oh, gotcha. Oh, sorry. Don't worry, we'll cut it out in post. No, we won't. Actually, we've been talking enough. We could probably cut this into three episodes.
Yeah, we probably could. Oh, well, that would give us some more time.
There we go. Anyway, so what was the So he uses his like pencil and his words, and he kills a bunch of monsters.
Yeah, and yeah, it's I feel like they really stretch to get the actual number in there. It's not like using words and numbers together. It's using words and the number four together.
Yeah, that's pretty much it. The words are really the ones that do the trick, because what he uses, what is it? What is the word against the hypocrite? I can't remember.
Oh, it was humility, which lodges his mouth and inflates him. So, but nobody's
very sexy.
Yeah, nope. But nobody got their inflation fetish from this movie, I don't think.
No, they didn't. They didn't linger as much as in, like, you know, Charlie and the Chocolate Factory.
A boy named Charlie and the Chocolate Factory.
So they get, because he kills the hypocrite, he kills the overbearing know-it-all, and is there any other ones?
Yeah, he bombs the
the trivia.
Yes, with achievement, diligence, and work. And that's when the monsters all sort of put themselves together, and we get this scene where they form the words malice, prejudice, cruelty, hate. So, yeah, this is what you're talking about. It's like, oh no, all the bad things. But I guess...
Yeah, exactly.
I guess the point here is that all the bad things are kind of derived from ignorance.
I mean, yeah, that's okay. It's just funny. It's like, oh no, hate, prejudice, cruelty. Don't worry, we will defeat these with letters and numbers. Okay.
Well, they all got
just like in real life.
They all get laid low with one slap of the monster's tail, and then Talk makes a play for bravery and bites the monster's ankle, and he gets knocked flying, and he can't move anymore, and you can hear broken parts, which is a sort of shocking reminder that he's mechanical.
Yeah, yeah.
Which I think is one of the ways that, you know, making his watch nature a little more subtle pays off.
Yeah. It lets them kind of like get a little gruesome without actually being gruesome.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Like, I mean, this is actually like, you know, I feel like this is maybe it's a sign of the times. There's a little bit of stakes in this.
Yeah.
You know, like I don't know how to describe this, because when I watched this as a kid, I mean, I saw this. I don't think I actually was like, oh, shit, he's actually dead. I mean, I think I was pretty confident that they'd bring him back. But at the same time, I feel like that was actually a risk in older cartoons. Like, they might actually kill a character.
Yeah, as we're fond of saying on this show, we hadn't yet nailed down the algorithm. So, you know,
yes.
You couldn't predict what a movie would do quite as well. Sometimes a movie would surprise you.
Yeah, it's a sort of thing where, like, it's weird now when you watch, like, you know, like, Disney movies now, and they're like, oh, we're going to tug at your heartstrings by, like, this character's, you know, gonna die or sacrifice or something. Well, yeah, but they're going to come back, you know? It's like, you're trying to make me sad, but I know they're not going to actually die.
Well, I mean, they killed off one character in The Princess and the Frog, but, I mean, at the same time, it was kind of like, who cares?
Yeah, it was like, oh, kill him, and everyone's like, oh, yeah, but we didn't like that guy. we don't like that Firefly. How do we know? Well, nobody's merchandised anything with him in it.
No.
I don't see him. I don't see his face on any Burger King cups.
Oh, you don't see any, you don't see any Bambi's mom merchandise.
Yeah. I mean, to be fair, though, you're right. That was actually pretty surprising what had happened in the film. It was like, oh, they killed that bug. Jeez. All right.
They killed the bug.
God,
Woody did not choose to return to the kids. So, you know, sometimes they surprise you.
Yeah. All right. I mean, That's true. I'll give them credit. Sometimes they do. But anyway, so Talk, it looks like he might be dead. So Milo has to, you know, get up to the castle in the air, to get Rhyme and Reason. And the castle in the air. It's got this kind of like the stairway of transparent like slats in the air that when you step on them, they disappear, kind of like, I don't know, like video game tiles, I guess.
Yeah. In the book, it was a rope bridge, and the monsters cut it once Milo and his friends were past them, sending the castle in the air flying.
So, oh, okay, interesting. So it was actually tethered down in the in the book. Huh. Okay. I mean, this is a cool visual, so I'm kind of glad they switched this up a little bit.
Yeah, it's what I call the Ruby Slipper rule, where, you know, you can if you can improve something in your movie by, you know, by making it more visually striking, that's good. But if you change it for no reason, then that's a little different.
Yeah. And we finally, sounds weird saying rhyme and reason. The princess's rhyme and sweet rhyme and pure reason are in the castle. And the princess pure reason is really, she really doesn't like it when Emmanuel Kant criticizes her. it really pisses her off. No, anyway, I thought it's kind of weird. They're kind of silhouettes.
Yeah, I felt like Chuck Jones wasn't confident in his ability to draw pretty girls.
Yeah, I think so. I think he was like, look, we need to make sure these are serious characters, you know, because these are the ones that they've been trying to rescue. So we're going to be a little abstract. In the book, they look like Feiffer girls.
Yes, they looked like Jules Feiffer girls. They don't look any different.
No, they look like the dancer in his Village Voice comics. Man, you know, looking at his illustrations, you really see the influence that he had on Berkeley Breathed, though.
Yeah, you're right. And you immediately made me think of the Bloom County with A Dance to the Power of Women. Women, fear them. That was like a direct Feiffer ripoff, wasn't it?
Yeah. It was very, you're right, actually. But so he gets, so I guess, what happens when he rescues them? Is it like in the movie? Do they just,
in the movie, they can fly away, but, in the book, since Talk is not hurt, and they get the castle gets set free by the monsters and goes sailing away, but Talk says, "Time flies. I can get you down."
Oh, okay. So we cut it down. Right.
Yeah. So he can get them down for just a short time, but just long enough to get them barely over the heads of the demons who are still after them, and they flee down the mountain with the princesses riding on Talk. And just as they're about to lose their breath and as the monsters are about to engulf them, they hear a horn in the distance and look forward, and Azaz and the Mathemagician have teamed up and have brought all their soldiers to fight with them.
Oh, okay. That's pretty cool, actually.
Milo slowly raised his weary head, and there in the horizon, as far as the eye could see, stood the massed armies of wisdom, the sun glistening from their swords and shields and their bright banners slapping proudly at the breeze. There in the lead was King Azaz, his dazzling armor embossed with every letter in the alphabet, and with him the Mathemagician brandishing a freshly sharpened staff. From his tiny wagon, Dr. Discord hurled explosion after explosion to the delight of the soundkeeper, while the busy din collected them all at once. And in honor of the occasion, Chroma the Great led his orchestra in a stirring display of patriotic colors. Everyone Milo had met during his journey had come to help. The men of the marketplace, the miners of Digitopolis, and all the good people from the valley and forest. Cringing in fear, the monsters of ignorance turned in flight.
Oh, wow. Okay. I gotta say, like, because for most of this movie, I've been pretty okay with the changes that Chuck Jones made to the book. I can understand why they were like, look, this might go over budget if we do this, or they were like, it might be, maybe they thought it was anticlimactic that it wasn't Milo doing all the heroics, but I think I would have really liked to see everyone that we've met over the course of this film like come together in the end and like kick some monster ass.
Yeah, we kind of get that with the ending song, where we get to see everybody, you know, changed and returned to their normal wisdom form by the return of Rhyme and Reasonum. But it's still not quite the same.
No, I mean it's good, but it's nice to see, like, I don't know, like the idea that they would all come to help Milo is kind of drives home the idea that they have in some way been changed by their interactions with Milo.
Yeah,
and now
exactly.
They're inspired to come help him, you know.
I read somewhere that you can tell that a movie has been made from a black perspective when it's about the community coming together as opposed to a single hero.
Interesting.
They were pointing that out about the Black Panther movie, which is definitely what happens. Although all of what's it called? The Black Panther's country. All of them, Wakanda. Wakanda comes to fight alongside him. But I also noticed this about the movie, The Meteor Man. You remember that one?
I do. Yes, I remember that. But I was actually about to say The Meteor Man for that.
So, I mean, obviously this movie was not made from a black perspective, but it was, but on the other hand, Norton Juster he is not black, but he has a biracial granddaughter who was the subject of his later book, the Hello Goodbye Window. So there's a little bit of touch in there.
Interesting. Interesting. So, there may be some link there. I guess they were like, look, this is 1970. They're wooing a white audience for this film.
Yeah.
So they were like, look, we can't, none of this community togetherness shit. We need everyone
is an
individual.
Either, but
everyone's an individual in isolation. So, even without this grand finale, it's still like a satisfying end to the movie.
It is a satisfying conclusion. And we get the last reappearance of the weatherman, who has been dangling from his balloons like Winnie the Pooh the whole time. And he's the one that helps them down as the princesses, who apparently can just fly away at any time now because Milo brought the two kings together again. And
So they're not like people in the movie.
There's something
they're
else,
like, whatever.
Everyone else has been
like
more
said,
person than metaphor, but they're more metaphor than person.
Yeah. I mean, I think you're right. It was just Chuck Jones is like, I can't draw a hot chick. All right, let's do it this way.
Hey, if you wanted hot chicks, you should have gotten, Bob Clampett to direct this.
Truth. I guess they were like, who does the princesses? Is that June Foray, I'm guessing?
Yeah, June Foray is one of them. The other one is Patty Gilbert, who doesn't seem to have a Wikipedia page.
Oh, okay. Interesting. I'm surprised they had a second female voice actor in those days.
Man, maybe she was just somebody they hired from The Office. I don't know.
Yeah, maybe. It's like, it was like Nothing But Trouble when Dan Aykroyd was like, I'm getting in the giant baby suit. I need someone else to go in this other one. And it's like, who do we get? This rando, some rando. In his one theatrical role.
The guy who dressed as a giant baby.
Yeah, it's like Dan Aykroyd as Bobo and Guy as Lil Devil. Nothing But Trouble. Is anything else happened before Milo just pops back out of the toll booth?
Well, we have a big celebration, and we get to see everybody returning to their original station, and there's a big celebration, and then we just go straight to Milo popping right out of the toll booth. But again, in the book, this is even worse than Bill Corbett's podcast about Lord of the Rings. Damn. In the book, we have the great moment where King Azaz and the mathematician finally tell Milo the one thing that they could never tell him, that they were holding back. They could never reveal that it was impossible. But if we told you, you might not have gone. And as you've discovered, so many things are possible just as long as you don't know they're impossible.
It makes you think.
Yeah. And so then there's 3 days of feasting and frolics and hijinks. And then Milo has to go home. And he says an emotional goodbye to his friends. Milo embraced the bug, who in his most typical fashion was heard to mumble gruffly, but whose damp eyes told quite a different story. Then the boy threw his arms around Toc's neck and for just a moment held on very tightly. And just as he's leaving, he hears the kings start to argue again and goes, oh no, I hope they don't start all over again. But just as in the movie, he comes home and finds it's still today. It's still the exact same day he left, but that suggests something interesting, because you remember what the tollbooth told him when he was first starting out?
What did it tell
him? It said that if not completely satisfied, your wasted time will be refunded.
Oh, so he's gonna, not a whole lot. That's the loophole.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, here's your 5 minutes back.
Don't spend it all in one place. No, I'm just saying that maybe he wasn't satisfied. Maybe he didn't learn anything, so they sent him back to the first time, to when he started.
Oh, you might be right. Well, what did Milo learn from this whole experience?
Well,
not to be bored, I guess.
Yeah, he learned that the world is worth exploring, and it's up to you to do so. And the first thing he does after this is pick up the phone, and his wet sock friend Ralph is still there. And he's like, where you been for the last 5 minutes? Just as a big toll booth package lands in his room.
Yeah. So this is not in the book, right?
No, this specific part, no, but in the book it says that Milo's head is full of everything else as he goes through his next day at school, and he runs home excited to go back through the toll booth again, but the toll booth is gone, and now he has a note that says we trust everything has been satisfactory and hope you understand why we had to come and collect it. You see, there are so many other boys and girls waiting to use it too. It's true that there are many lands you're still to visit, some of which are not even on the map, and wonderful things to see that no one else has even imagined, but we're quite sure that if you really want to, you'll find a way to reach them all by yourself. Yours truly. The signature was blurred and couldn't be read.
So that actually ties in a little bit to my theory.
What's your theory?
So not much of a theory, but when we watched this at the very end of the movie, the toll booth like wraps itself up and flies out the window.
Yeah.
And he gets on the phone with Ralph, and Ralph is like, oh, I can't talk anymore. Like, a big weird box just appeared in my house, right?
Yeah.
And so it's like, okay, so Ralph was going to go on an adventure too. But I was talking to my wife, and I was like, wait a second, though. Milo has solved all the problems that were happening in Digitopolis and Dictionopolis and everything. So Ralph's going to show up, and it's like, yeah, everything's fine. You just drive around. Don't need an adventure. There's no quest. Everything's fine, right? So how is that going to help Ralph and his personal growth? It won't, right?
Well, so keep in mind, it was not like toll booth world. No one else had ever seen the toll booth. So what makes you think that this toll booth can only take you to the lands beyond?
Exactly. That's it. We realized, because we were talking about this, we realized, oh, every person who goes to the toll booth, you go to a completely different dimension.
Yeah, so he's going to go to some sort of, like, I don't know, like, I don't know, punctuation marks world? I don't know.
Yeah, he's going to go into the emoji movie.
Well, what is more important, live action or animation?
Animation.
Yeah, animation. Definitely animation. Sorry, Butch Patrick.
But yeah, so tell me, you were going to say, now you said that Norton Juster had some specific criticisms of this film.
Let me see. Norton Juster. Interview with Norton Juster about the Phantom Tollbooth and writing for children. Okay. Let's hope this loads for me. Okay. Now, the interviewer, in the middle of this interview with Norton Juster, the interviewer says, one of your other wonderful books, The Dot and the Line, was adopted into an Academy Award-winning film. Wouldn't The Phantom Tollbooth also lend itself perfectly to animation?
It was done as a full-length animated feature film by MGM with live scenes, live beginning and end. And when you go through the tollbooth is when it turned into animation. It was a film I never liked. I don't think they did a good job on it. It's been around for a long time. It was well-reviewed, which also made me angry. And for some reason, I don't know why, they never put it into general release. But it played a lot and still does on television. I don't know if they've ever read, heard, saw, or read about it being on TV. It's drivel. Don't worry about it. I don't know the rights anymore, but the conglomerate that owns it, MGM, Turner, Time Warner, AOL, they're now very seriously considering remaking the movie as an all live-action film. That's the way I'd prefer it. Whether it happens or not, I don't know. I've had enough dealings with the crazy movie world to know that a vast majority of things never happen as they say. And if they do happen, they happen at a glacially slow pace. What I try to do is put it out of my mind. If it does go ahead, I hope I will have some function in it, because I'd like to do it in a way I think it should be done. Disappointingly, okay. He'll never get to.
Well, I was going to say at first, like, I feel like that's embarrassing when you're the reporter, like, wouldn't it make a great movie? It was a movie. It's like, should have done your homework. But, I mean, in their defense, in the days before the internet, it might be a little harder to research your subject before an interview, I guess. Although I think knowing that their thing was adapted to a movie is kind of a big thing to know, yeah. You know? I mean, you kind of look like an idiot when you're like, wouldn't it be great? But I'm actually still, he didn't say what it was about the movie he didn't like. It sounded like he mostly was like just annoyed at the processes of Hollywood and didn't like animation. He wanted it live action.
Yeah, that's interesting. I wonder if, his problem seemed to be about animation. I'm looking for other interviews, but now I were just mostly into his eulogies, and I can't think anything else, but I seem to remember him saying that he wished it were, that he wished it were live action. So he's just one of those cranks who doesn't like animation. Was like, that didn't really happen. That was just a drawing.
I mean, I feel like you couldn't make this movie live action in 1970.
No, definitely not.
You could, but it would look like shit. I'm sorry. Like, what would you just have, like, everyone, you'd have to do it like one of those when they just film a stage play and like Talk would just be a guy in a fursuit and the humbug would just be a guy with like some shitty face paint,
Yeah, it would look just like the wonderful Land of Oz.
Yeah, it's like, theoretically, I guess, like, how would you make monsters? Like, we do some stop motion, I guess? I don't know.
That would be pretty cool, actually.
In 1970?
I mean,
it would be, yeah. I can imagine,
if you could get something like, Ray Harryhausen to do some of the monsters, and some of the other ones would be, just fine as, as people in suits. You could just put a mask on for the terrible trivium, but, I don't know. Yeah. You would end up looking. Whoops. Hang on. I was about to share something with you. Let's see. Copy image. Yes, this is what I'm imagining the humbug looking like in that picture.
Yeah, exactly. Yes, like this.
We will not share this image with you.
No, just use your imagination. Use your imagination.
It would look like this.
So I guess when it so in the end, what do you think of the Phantom Tollbooth?
I like the movie. I don't agree with Mr. Juster that it wasn't a good adaptation, but I don't blame him for being disappointed. I mean, knowing the message that the story gives about imagination, I can absolutely see that the version in his head was so much more spectacular than this.
Yeah, I'd agree. I think it sounds like from hearing about the book and, seeing your videos, it sounds like it's a fairly good adaptation, as close, as good as you could do. in 1970. And, you know, it's inevitable that, like, you're it's going to lose something from the book.
Yes. I mean, so. Yeah, it left out a lot of the book, but I don't think that was Mr. Juster's problem with it, because later in life, he wrote the libretto for a stage play version that is still being performed in schools today. And this stage play version leaves out the humbug.
Why even bother then?
It's just Milo and Talk for the most part. I was just like, it seems like, you know, if you're going to leave that much out, then what was your problem? Was that his problem seems to be that it had too much of his work in it.
I mean, the way he kind of said it, it was like, I think like you said earlier, maybe he was just kind of pissed that he wasn't consulted.
Yeah. I mean, his complaint is that they used so much of his dialogue, but he didn't get writer credit on it.
Yeah. I mean, to be fair, I think a lot of writers are just like, you know, just feel like they seem to overestimate the amount of influence that a writer has in the whole Hollywood process.
Yes, it's a big job with lots and lots and lots of people, lots of mouths to feed.
Yeah. But yeah, this was a good one. I think it's definitely, it was definitely a lot more fun to watch than Wizard of Id.
Yes. And we ended up talking for more than double its running time about it. We love this movie. But we were able to work a lot of talk about Jules Feiffer into it too. While I was doing this, I was finding some interesting Jules Feiffer things for us to explore, including Jules Feiffer stage play that adapts his comics into live performances.
Oh, well, there's something.
Yeah, I don't know when we're going to be ready to dip our toes into the legitimate theater, but when we do, it'll be there.
Nice. Well, I'd love to talk more, but I'm afraid I gotta go because some weird box just appeared here.
A box? Oh, boy!